Welcome, everybody. This is Information Service Engineering, lecture number 13, and we have reached our hand-on example on women's soccer data analysis. Okay, so as usual, what we want to do here is, of course, to demonstrate how to do a data analysis of the data we have already acquired in one of the previous sections of the lecture. So for data analysis, what are we going to do? We have to import, as usual, a few libraries. So we will use NumPy, we will use SciPy, we will use Pandas, scikit-learn then to make predictions, and matplotlib to plot pretty figures. You know this already. So first load all the necessary libraries, which is rather fast. Okay, next we are going to read data. And we read this into a pandas data structure. We have already used this, and this is quite handy for data analysis. So the usage is more or less straightforward. If you're interested in it, of course, you can read the Python documentation here where we have put the link for you. Okay, so what we are going to do here is, of course, this is the URL of the data of the spreadsheet that you have already seen with the women's soccer data that we have acquired from Wikidata. And here we read it as CSV, as it is here, into a pandas data structure. And we want to look at the first five items. Therefore, goals is the data structure where we read it into. And head is a method that displays the first five rows. Okay, so you see this goes rather quickly. It's not so huge. There are about 500 data points in there. And you see here the parameters. So we have columns, we have number of teams of the soccer player, we have the number of total goals, total matches, total citizenships, height, weight, the position played, the birth date, the number of jobs on the sites besides being a soccer player, and the importance. And this is by on how many wiki pages this player occurs. And remember, this is women soccer, so not male soccer. So we don't have as many players as for the male section, but you may try this out, everything, of course, also with other kind of data. Okay, first let's get some insight about our data. So let's describe the data set. And you see here already, it makes sense. So we see here we have 428 rows here. You see the minimum for teams, for example, is 1. The maximum of teams is 24. Wow, somebody played in 24 teams. And you see here also what's the mean. And so this and you also see 50%, that's the median. So we have talked about this when we were explaining box plots in the last section of the lecture. And you see 25 and 75% is the first quartile. This is the third quartile. And yeah, you see also here the standard deviation, for example. Okay, this gives us some interesting insights about the data. So for example, total number of goals. Oh, there's somebody with 600 goals. This is really a lot. But yeah, you see here 50%, so is at 14 goals, which is okay. Also the number of matches, this range is, wow, between 1100 and minimum is 2. Citizenships are not so many, 1 or 2. The height, okay, let's have a look at the height. Okay, in the height, you see we might have a problem, so we have to do further data cleaning, because the height is between 1.57, which there probably is given in meters, and between 187, which is of course not meters, this should be centimeters. So I guess if I look at the data here, so the mean you see 153, and you see here 167 is here, and 162 is the first quartile. So we will have a few outliers which are given in meters and not in centimeters, but we will take care about that later. Then you see here we have the weight ranging between 40, probably kilograms, not pounds, and 150, whoop, wow, yeah, we can't say whether this is correct or not. The number of side jobs ranges between 1 and 3, and the importance ranges between 0 Wikipedia pages pointing on that entry in Wikidata. That means, of course, Yes, in Wikidata there are also players or pages which are, have no reference in Wikipedia because they are only in Wikidata, so this is possible. Okay, you see by simply by this describe method we have already gained first insights. Now let's look at the histograms, then we see something about the data distribution. So this is the next thing, we are simply plotting histograms. You see here that's the distribution for the team, so we have many, many people only participating in a few teams and a few people participating in many teams. So this is the typical long tail distribution we have here. Then we have here total number of goals, same kind of distribution, total matches also rather similar, total number of citizenship, yeah, most of them only have one citizenship, a few of them have two, importance, a few of them are only in Wikidata, so this is this here, and then the rest is here somehow normally distributed, interesting. Starts with 150, ranges to almost 200 or more. That's the weight, also kind of a normal distribution. This is the site shops, either one or two. And this is the importance. But however, we see here the height. This is some problems. This is the meter fraction and this is the centimeter fraction. So we seem to have some problem with the heights. We might have a closer look on that. So you see it here again. Which means, yeah, we have to do some data cleaning. So you have to go back to the CSV file and have to take care and then simply change these few outliers. And since this is given in meters and this in centimeters, you can normalize the data to centimeters. This is what you can do. We already arranged this for you, which means now we have to load a new data set. So we did it again. And there you see now here, these are the weights, and let's see how now with a new cleaned up data set our histogram looks like. And you see here, yeah, so this is kind of a more or less normal distribution. So however, we have here some 40 people who are rather small, but of course this looks much better than the old distribution. Okay, you remember we have learned about box plots to make sense of the data. So let's see box plots for all of our data we have here that is numerical. So this is the number of teams, the number of total goals, total matches, citizenships, height, weight, site shop, importance. And you see here, these are already outliers. So people scoring more than here, let's say 150 goals are already old outliers, or people playing in more than 400 matches. Very interesting. And also the importance being more than, what would it be, 180 something Wikipedia pages, this is already considered something like an outlier. But this doesn't mean that it's wrong. It's only, you know, above this whisker of 1.5 times the interquartile range. We can have a closer look on that. So you see with the number of teams, oh wow, many, some of them have played in already more than 20 teams. This is a lot, of course, yeah. Then let's have a look at the goals. You see the goals again, then the total matches, the citizenships. So only, so most of them have one, only one, or see a data point, or a few data points are here at two. Then we have here the height, so with shortly above 1.85 meters, you are already an outlier here. Then the weight. Yeah, there are a few over there, but this seems to be quite normal. The number of site shops, the number of importance. So you can go down and analyze this again. What you also can do is you can relate in a box plot different values of a field with all the others. So for example, we can here see the total number of goals with respect to the position that the player has played. So we put here, so we do a box plot, we say we want to have the column we want to display is the total goals, and by means, okay, according to each value of the position, we want to have a box plot for that. How does that look? Very interesting. So you see here, so these are the positions. We have attacker, center back, defender, forward, fullback, goalkeeper, midfielder, winger, and this is the number of goals. And probably as expected, so here the most goals are scored probably by the forwarder and not by the fullback. Interestingly, also the goalkeeper scores goals. I don't know if this is only, you know, if he scores for his team or for the other's team. We have to see. Okay, now how much of the data is there and how is it structured? So let's simply have a look here. How many of the data we see here for each of the positions. So we look here exactly at the goals with respect to the position, and we count the values here. So you see we have 140 midfielders, we have 113 defenders and so on, only a few fullbacks, three. So most of the people playing here are, yeah, either midfielder, defender or forward. Only 42 goalkeepers are recorded here. So if we look at the data and we want to see whether, you know, there is some correlation among the numerical data we have here. For example, if we want to predict at some point the number of goals, we would see, are there any, let's say, in the total number of goals, if we look at that, any deep red spots that we see there a correlation between the data. Of course, there is a correlation between total number of goals and total number of matches, because if you have played in lots of matches, then of course the likelihood that you score more goals, of course, is high. The same holds probably then also for importance. So where's importance? We don't, there is importance over there. And importance, of course, is related to the number of teams, but not so much to the number of goals. That's interesting. Okay, so let's see what's the correlation here for the total number of matches and the total number of goals. And we do this here again by a scatter plot. So we plot here the stuff that is in this pandas data structure goals. And as you see here, so we give here an alpha value of 0.3, which means the plots are not completely solid, so they are a bit transparent. That you see where many points are there, it's of course then less transparent. So here we have on the y-axis the total number of goals and on the x-axis the total number of matches, and this looks already a bit like there could be a correlation somehow. Yeah, okay. We can put more in that scatterplot diagram. So for example, we could include the weight also there, and what else, and the height. So let's have a look how this looks then here. What did we do here? So the total number of matches is indicated by the point size, and the height is here indicated by the color. And what we have here is the total number of goals in the y-axis and the weight in the x-axis. You see here there is not necessarily, let's say, a correlation between the weight and the number of goals. You see here of course a kind of correlation between the color you have here and the weight scheme. So probably, you know, if you are not so high, then your weight is probably lower. This is of course quite logical. This is kind of a correlation you might already see. So try it out. So use different features you have there that you can visualize. And remember what you can do in these two-dimensional diagrams. Of course, you can interrelate here, of course, in a scatterplot the stuff. You can influence the point size and you can influence the color. Or you could also then introduce also a third dimension. Okay, let's see whether there is a correlation to the number of goals and the other field. So if we look at that, of course, direct correlation we can see here to the total number of matches and also the number of teams you have played in and the importance. Interestingly, also a little bit on the side shots, but the goals are not dependent on the weight, the height, or of course the citizenships. Okay, the position of course is not in there because we have already seen related to specific positions, we might have a preference of many or not so many goals. So the forwarders achieve the most goals, we remember that. We can of course then also create a numerical representation of this data simply by assigning an arbitrary number then to a specific value we have here. So we do this here in the next field, and what we see here, so we encode, or we factorize this, it's called here, our data at the column position here, and this will be factorized, which means a number is assigned here exactly to a specific value of position. And you see here the first 10 of these goals position encoded, and you see here this is 0001103, so this is an arbitrary number for a specific position. So to see the encoding, you see it here, so 0 means midfielder, 1 means goalkeeper, 2 means forward, 3 means center back, and so on. So this is then the encoding we have chosen. And simply to see it here, so you have midfielder, position number is now also part here of the data, as you see here in the goals data structure that we are dealing with. Okay, now we've done a lot of data analysis, let's go for a prediction task. One thing we could predict from the numerical data that we have would be the total number of goals that a player has scored according to the numerical values we have already gathered for him. So how can we do this? So we have prepared here another board for you. Simply unwrap it, and then you see that we want to predict the number of achieved goals, but this time not with a linear regressor. We want to do this with a more, let's say, sophisticated model with a random forest regressor. You might remember random forest from our decision trees lecture. Random forests are an ensemble method, which means what you do there is you create different kind of decision trees to solve the problem, and then in the end you average their result out among all of them. So what we have to do with our training data is, first we have to separate the target data, which is the total number of goals, from the rest. So this is what we do here in the very first panel. Okay, you see we have 428 rows of data, 8 features, and then in Y there, here is the target data, and the target data, of course, is the column of total goals. Next split we do is, of course, splitting into training and test data, and we do this here with the default values, and this means our 428 rows will be divided in 321 training examples and 107 test examples. Okay, now we create a random forest regressor and train the model and evaluate the root mean square error. So this is here the evaluation criteria. Remember, this is not a classification problem, this is a regression problem. We have to find out, if we do a prediction, how much do we deviate from the truth. And this, of course, can be computed in the test set that we have. And there we simply add up or look at the average error, and of course this has from this we do we take the squared error simply to get rid of the plus minus dilemma, and then we do the square root in the end again. Okay, so look at that. We from scikit-learn we are importing the random forest regressor and the mean squared error, and then we create our random forest regressor model with 9 estimators. This means we are using 9 decision trees in the beginning, so this is completely arbitrary, you can use any other number there. We train it here with model fit, and then we do our prediction. So this is our test prediction for the X test set, and then the difference between the test set and the predicted test set, we are computing here the error between prediction and the truth. And from that we are doing the square root, and this then is the RMSE that we are looking at. Okay, and in the end we print which kind of parameters have been used for that random forest. You see here the root mean square error is 57.68. This means in the end, for each number that we predict from the 8 values we have, we deviate in the mean or in the average by 57 goals. This is already a lot. I would say it's too much to make some kind of a valid prediction. And here you see all of the parameters that have been used. And these parameters, this is the interesting thing then for machine learning, You can optimize, you can do a grid search over many of these parameters, try them out in a systematic way, and then simply optimize them via grid search to determine what is, of course, what are the perfect hyperparameters or the best hyperparameters for that size of a problem. Okay, we do this later. What we do next is here simply we plot the original results. This is blue here. And we see the predicted results. This is orange. Then you see here on the y-axis, and this is the number of goals. And of course, you see here all our samples that we have here, just a bit more than 100. And you see for some, it fits quite well. For others, it doesn't really fit well. Okay. We could also have a look at the feature importance. And this tells us that here, the most important feature so far was teams and total matches, for example. So this is already interesting to see, because we already knew that there was a correlation between these and the total number of goals. The next set of things that comes here is the hyperparameter tuning, and we do this via grid search. This takes a while, therefore we don't do it live, only to explain to you. So you have to import here the randomized search and grid search. And for the number of estimators, we simply create an array of 8 different values between 4 and 200. So this is our number of estimators, one of the parameters. And then we have a vector for different kind of minimum sample split, minimum sample leave. So this is the minimum number of samples when a split takes place in a node in the tree, and so on. So you can try out different parameters with lots of values here. And then you simply click here, and it starts training and optimizing and so on and so on. And this might take a while. And after that, then here in the next panel, what you can do again, you compute the root mean square error for the best estimator model that you have. And then you see whether you are better than your baseline or whether it didn't work out well. Okay, try it out. We leave this for you then to see how this works. So further analysis of the data itself, as well as further prediction tasks, are left to the reader. That's it. Thank you very much.